Well, at the request of, one of the attorney, they've asked us to take another look at the revised site plan. Because of some time constraints on the walkway, so I did voice all those specifications.
What were the time constraints?
Well, I can't explain it all.
They changed the, I'll let you explain it to you.
Yeah.
The parking standard. The time constraint is that tomorrow, for Housing Finance Corporation, will release its application, and you will have 60 days to have the application back turned in. Clear that, it has to be an engineered plan and a full set of architectural lines, we need time to design it. But as an old, the opening salvo in that application process is that they need, it's not necessarily an approval, we went through this last week, but it is a statement of either appropriateness or the fact that the city will, you don't actually have to support it, what you have to do is say that you don't have an exception to it, you don't not want the project. This is a qualified zone, is identified by the IRS as a segment of need. I bought a copy of the University of Florida's report that identifies that need, and I leave that with your chair. If you'd like to read that, it actually shows the methodology and the amount of households that are determined, the need, the amount of household needs that are determined is 115. This developer has targeted 52 for this property, which falls within the zone. The QPC zone is actually a trapezoid, and it was, I think we may have explained this last time, it was difficult to find property big enough to accommodate somewhere north of 40 units and south of 115 units. The developer does not want to overbite, if you will, does not want to take more than they think they need. They think that they might be able to alleviate some of the pent-up demand. And, mm-hmm. and that pent-up demand is in this report, so I'll give you this as part of the work.
Let me give you a little bit of background that, as you know, Mark and I were working really hard last fall trying to get all this together to get the town, because they said they need the plan approved before the first of the year, because they're supposed to make their applications in January, which is the designated time for the Florida Housing Finance Corporation, which is the HUD arm in Florida. And along about the first of the year, they got a notice from Florida Housing Finance Corporation said that they had been through a state audit. The state said they need to change some of their forms and the process they're going through. So everything just went on hold. And that's when I sent letters out to the city commissioners and the school board and saying, no, they're not allowed to put in an application now, so there's nothing we can do to wait.
So everything, is this a 6-month cycle or a yearly cycle?
It typically goes through a yearly cycle, but most of the time there's twice a year they were doing before. And they thought it was going to be in January, but it got moved, and it looks like they're releasing the information now with the submission date being 1st of September.
Is that right, for the application?
1st of October. 1st of October for
application. Okay.
Anyway, what we found out, and this is, he and I have been through the same every way you can do it, because we won't hear from them for a week, and all of a sudden they've got 19 requests. This is my feelings based on what we went through last fall. They had two other projects, and we had developers down, we met with Betty and all of us, and we sat and talked about it, and they said, yeah, there's a good possibility we may get it. It may take 2 or 3 years, you know, but this is just a process you go through. But what we found out after the fact was there's two other projects they were working on. One was in Miami, was in Key West, and somehow they've just kind of gone away. Things didn't work out and not move forward. And also, we've been elevated to the front, that they feel like we're a target item. We've got a good opportunity to be able to get this one approved. That's our opinion based on what they're telling us now. So,
I can add a little to that. I was the architect of the project in Miami. The project in Miami was an existing project where there are basically apartment homes that are right on the street, as you would find in other urban areas, not a gated community, not an apartment complex per se. The rules that the Florida Housing Finance Corporation puts out are amended every year during the legislature. This year, they took the rulings that allow existing buildings over 30 years old out. So that project no longer qualified, so it just became a non-project, it evaporated. So this causes this developer to start seeking other opportunities for affordable housing projects. Unfortunately, I will say this. what Florida Housing wants to finance now looks more like an apartment complex than it does regular housing on a street. That fits their model.
One of the things that we did once we got into it, then they came back and said, listen, then the number crunchers showed up and said, we've got to do this, and then they looked at the plan and said, we really need to bump this up to 52 units, from 46 to 52. We want a clubhouse and we want a pool. So we came back to the city and to the school board, so we're talking about increasing the size a little bit. It's still all in that northwest corner there, and there's a road that for people turning to go down to the bus barn, it does not get into that road, it goes close to the road and goes back towards the gymnasium. In doing so, we're able to increase the price of it. So the city's point, there was about 116 and 19, it's going to go like to 179 or something like that. The school board bumps up 25,000 or so. The city's got some increases there. Also, the city managed to tell us that there between where this thing stops and the gymnasium is 140 or 50 feet or so, that she wants to have it turned into a park. That actually helps the complex for as far as qualifying points and things of that sort. So there's a lot of things that have taken place. We've been kicking around stormwater now for the last 6 weeks because we've just tried to find out what it works, how it works, how it has to be, and we've gone through lots of different things in relation to that. And it's designed as just a dry pond on the south end that makes that kind of a barrier between the school project and the playground and the gymnasium. So that's where we are. They're really fired up about it. We've been talking a lot about it. We're working hard on it. And we're just now finding out that we really weren't even sure a week ago the date that they were going to start releasing the, I guess it's an RFP, isn't it?
The RFP will come out on Thursday the 1st.
So they put it out today and said, here it comes. So that's what we've been working on for the last few months. And Mark can talk you through the design and why it changed and how it changed and what they expect out of it.
So go ahead. You've still got two exits, two entrances, basically in the same place, except the 17th Street is moved to the center.
Correct.
The complex. Your stormwater is basically on the same side.
Correct.
You do have parking not 17th side, not 17th Street.
Though.
And you'll be parking there and then walking around the back of them into the entrances to the other parking.
Well, there's not a back and front anymore. This is sort of in response to Lynn's observation last night that there was a back and front. These are now centerline party walls, and both the front and the back are identical. So there is a front door facing all the streets, internal and external. So it's just a different door solution. There is no back door.
But the front on 17th Street is an accepted sidewalk.
That's correct.
And you got to walk through the center.
Yeah, I got it. Okay. That's correct. Now, there are some interesting proclivities that typically happen in affordable housing. When we sit down and do a calculation of the amount of parking that would be necessary for a typical apartment complex, based on your code, it's one per bedroom, so we'd have to have 102. Normally, in affordable housing, we have about half the number of cars. Because we have single families and because we very often, these units are aimed at, I'm going to say their language, not mine, lower income earner, first jobs. And in particular, this developer targets firefighters, police officers, sheriff's deputies, teachers, and nurses in areas where it's difficult for them to acquire property or to be able to buy a house. So this is not a permanent housing solution. This is a some place to live while you're building up till you can move out and buy a house. Because what we're seeking it's not subsidized housing, as you call it.
What is the qualifying income now?
Yeah,
it's qualifying income.
What is it?
$24,000.
Starts there, it goes
for household.
Well, it starts there. Like, remember, if you've got a family with two or three kids, it goes up to about $34,000, $36,000. But it starts down around $24,000, $36,000.
So it's not for the audience. It's not subsidized. It's a $24,000 minimum income right now is what it is. And then if you have two or three kids, I'm just saying it goes up to where the more people in the apartment, the more cost to get in there. Ma'am?
How high does it go up?
38,000.
About 38?
$36,000 to $38,000.
So it's not subsidized and,
And this is, that is also a good, because that's based on the median, a percentage of the median income of Franklin County. So if our county income goes up, then that slides up as well.
It does. It moves every time the county median income is re-reported and re-recorded.
Who will the actual owners be of this property?
Wentworth Properties.
Who?
Wentworth Properties.
Are they based somewhere?
In Orlando.
Orlando.
And they have these unit, they have these complexes statewide. The last one we finished was in Key West.
And if I remember from last time, they must retain it as this housing, affordable, did you call it?
Yeah, let me, if you want me to review that, I'll tell you how it works.
For 10 years?
No, 5th year.
Yes, 5th year.
10 years. There will be a deep restriction placed on it, and it's in each year you get three different audits. One, the HUD does an audit. Two, the state of Florida's Florida Housing Finance Corporation does one as well. But there's also, based on the way this thing is funded through tax credits, and I'll go to that in just a second, they also have an audit done, so it's very high standards on that. The way this thing is funded, that the federal government, and this is new to me, and I found it very exciting and interesting because I've never dealt with something like this before. What happens is once this project is approved, and here it goes, it starts at the federal HUD level, comes down to the state level, but the financing is actually issued through IRS tax credits. And what happens is, if, let's say, and I'll just pull numbers out there, they were trying to raise $5 million, and they may go sell off $5 million of these tax credits on Wall Street, or they may sell $1 million tax credits. But let's just say they were going to do that, and it was, as an example, this $1 million tax credit, they're issued like 75 to 80% of the whole funding process as tax credits. So the developer, because they're chosen, and the federal government is allowing investors to invest in affordable housing, they go and sell this tax credit, and it may sell for $900,000 to $950,000 for $1 million tax credit. But that purchaser gets to take that $1 million tax credit for 10 years. Now, so then when they form the group, this developer becomes the general partner, created a limited partnership, and he's the general partner, and all the people, these organizations, normally large corporations, buy in these tax credits, and they own 99% of that limited partnership. So they want their interest looked at as well, too. After 15 years, they have the option of dropping off and letting the developer take over. But they're on the hook for it for 15 years, because if it doesn't get funded or something, they still have to hand it to develop. And that's how it all gets there.
There's also a percentage of that which is held in escrow for maintenance, which ensures that this is kept up for 50 years.
Is there on-site personnel?
Yes, there are.
There will be an on-site manager, plus they will be hiring local people to take care of the manager and come in to, mow and clean and wash and clean, whatever. So,
right now,
how many parking places do you say you were short?
We're showing 96 right now, so we would be short between 4 and 8, depending on how you count. We're gonna have a few for the office because we think we're gonna have 4 or 5 employees. There's gonna be an on-site manager who will probably live in one of the units, and there's going to be an on-site maintenance person. So there's 2 full-time positions and probably 2 to 4 part-time positions.
Is it all right to talk about the mitigation for the parking?
Option.
One of the things we're looking at is an option because we're just a handful. We don't think in actual use we're going to be short. But the road where you pull in, it goes to the bus barn, not the school, it goes down to the after school program. One of the things that Betty suggested maybe is an option to mitigate is to get these developers to improve that road And if they're gonna be running big trucks, it needs to be done anyway, and I'm getting some prices right now, what it would take to put some parking down or something down to improve that road to make it nice enough to stand up to.
Is that with the dotted lines on that file?
Benny, you said that.
The dotted lines are parking, the dotted lines are parking that is within the setback, which is allowed in the code.
The dog park and the parks that are there, now, you said you wanted to make a park on the ball field, or the adjacent, near the barn.
Really, we haven't really made a definite decision if this happens with the dog park. The plan for the football field is to make it soccer fields.
Well, the.
Not sure where the dog park will be going.
Is there room to the bus barn, but that's a smaller area there, they don't need a few here.
I don't think it's enough room for your dog park there, but you got the whole baseball field.
I think it's probably gonna end up being over the baseball field, because the only reason it's used now, baseball fields are soccer. And we'd like to say we wanna make the football field separate soccer fields.
And this whole complex is gonna have buffer, correct, and plantings around it and all. Even on the, I imagine the retention pond is gonna be.
I think by law you have to fix those, don't you?
Yeah, we're gonna have to require that fence, because we do have an actual program over there, so it has to be required and have to be fixed.
After our meeting, just one little thing we did here a week or so ago, I sent an email back, said, is there a requirement from the Florida Housing Finance Corporation that we do fence? And they came back and said, no, there's not, that they prefer landscape. And I thought we prefer landscape too, but we didn't know if there was a requirement to do a big fence or something, we didn't, and there's not.
I know we hadn't seen any final plans and stuff, I guess that'll come later, but any fencing like that could be.
Well, two of the sides are protected by your culvert, which is about 6 foot deep, so we've got a moat.
That's what I wanted to.
We've got a moat on two sides.
And that's gonna have that fence is already there, I would anticipate that they're gonna leave that, I would think.
And as far as the parking mitigation, that's kind of standard for some of these.
I would do it so that it was getting a hedge, so it didn't look like a fence, it looked more like a planting.
Okay.
I have questions about my concerns along the project or about stormwater. But first, I don't think I was here. That's one meeting I've missed where you actually presented the site plan before. So on 17th Street currently, there is a ditch.
17th Street and Avenue Bell, there's a ditch.
Right.
There's a ditch on both sides.
Right, yes. I went by there. I was by that property.
There's not a ditch on that.
It runs
all the way down 17.
17.
There's a little ditch that runs behind somewhere there. Yes, there's a little ditch. This is definitely there. And this is the big deep one here. And actually, there's a swale currently that runs around here and feeds this. I was by there yesterday.
Correct.
Yesterday, a couple of days ago. Because that's been my foremost concern about this project and some other new projects around town, the stormwater. And right now, this is the only dry retention pond here that you have. And it looks like it's 21,000 square feet. But how deep is it? It's 21,000 square feet in area, but how deep is it?
It's only gonna be about 2 or 3 feet because the water table is pretty high over there.
Exactly, which is why they've got problems over there now. That's my concern. So just back to this, there is gonna be a fence here to prevent children or whatever from straying into that awful ditch.
I mean, you have to do that. Okay. You have to do that.
Okay. And what about, this is like a bridge that goes over that drainage area?
It'll be a culvert where we put a big concrete culvert in there and pave over it. So it'll in essence be a bridge, yes.
Yeah, because it's about as deep as I am tall at that point.
It's about 6 feet deep.
Yeah, it is.
And it's about 12 to 18 feet across, so hopefully not to build a bridge structure, but we're going to build something pretty close to it. And we have to make sure that the capacity underneath that is maintained so that conveyance retains its capacity.
So I guess my biggest question, because I do have, that's my biggest problem. I think we need this type of housing, I think, from what I'm hearing.
Well, let me help you there. We do have engineers that are looking at this, and that's who's sizing the stormwater. We're not making it up.
Right, and I've seen engineers in Caravelle that that have sized stormwater, give me more, but Carabel was washing away last week.
Tallahassee was washing away last week.
No, but you have to engineer for that, and that is a real concern, it's an issue that we're dealing with right now. So, anyway, not to get off the topic, but my question is, so what is it that we're asked to, what kind of approval, what category of approval is this? And where does it leave us as a board in terms of asking you or the developer that you represent to make changes if it appears at a later date, for instance, using the stormwater as an example, that it doesn't appear that it's going to be adequate or something like that. I just don't quite understand what it is that we're conveying today as a board.
I think what we're asking for is a certificate of appropriateness, and we will bring back to you the final engineered plans and the final engineered elevations and architectural plans. But we need that to move forward to the next step with the development and with the application to Florida Housing.
With everything we do, y'all approve this before. If it doesn't get funded, it's not approved, then we're through that process anyway.
Just a clarification. So you're not asking for a site plan approval or such approval?
No, I think that's an engineered plan that we'll come back with at a later
time.
You're asking
for a certificate of appropriateness that's appropriate for that zone area.
So according to my book, because I'm on the learning curve, it's preliminary approval granted by the Architectural Review Board, which is us, relating to the review of design, look, and use of proposed development within the city. This is the first review in a pre-approval phase for development. Okay, so as far as look goes, this isn't a site plan review. It doesn't sound like to me.
It's kind of a preliminary site plan approval because based on the final engineering, we may have to tweak it just a little bit. So, you know, we're not expecting you to say, sure, you approved this go forward.
I thought it was important enough to bring it back tonight because it's remarkably different than what you saw last time, and I didn't want to
absolutely
go into the application.
Yeah,
and when final engineering plans are done, we expect to bring it back. We don't expect to just go down and try to get a permit.
Yeah.
I'll come back for your final approval. Because once you're looking at engineered plans, and let's say the stormwater is smaller than expected, or maybe it needs to be larger than expected, and we're going to have to address those issues because depending on the final, and they have to spend the money to get the final engineering, so they don't do that unless they're going to get funded. Once they do that, then we'll bring it back, and whatever has to be tweaked in their position, they will start to
they don't want to spend a lot of money with architects and engineers until they're certain that the city's not going to have some objection to it.
What are we talking about total value of this land and building?
$6 to $8 million.
$6 to $8 million is probably fair.
Normal ad valorem taxes?
Yes.
Right, again, I want to emphasize, I think it's a great project, we need it, but I do have concerns about the stormwater issues because the dog park's out there on the site, I've been out there a lot, and it's frequently, yes, we had a lot of rain, but it's frequently a soggy site. So all this is paved in here except for which part I saw some provisions for pervious concrete.
We don't know yet.
Where does the stormwater go once it reaches this ditch? This is where it goes, right? Where does it go?
From that side, it goes into
17th Street.
But where does it go from the
17th Street?
North and then west.
In the 23rd.
In our yards, okay. Across the street, that's where it goes, in our yards.
It goes north and then. Does it cross 17th there, Ben?
That's like.
Does it at the corner of 17?
It crosses at
17.
Yes, it crosses there. Yes,
it does. It goes out of that creek area. Is that doing okay on that end down there? Where Junior built this new place and all that? Isn't that about where that is?
Yeah, that's about where it is.
No problems or anything?
Well, I went by there and videotaped him because I went around and videotaped. I do this frequently. Our stormwater issues, not just here but in Carabel. And the ditch was running very freely. The big ditch, of course, it is as deep as I am tall. However, in front of on Avenue L, that swale there, which isn't terribly deep, maybe at the deepest 12 inches point, it gets a little deeper down here. It was quite full of water. I've seen it there. I've seen it full of water frequently. And then my concern is when you pave this area because it's basically all pervious now. But if you're going to pave all this area, you're going to be generating a whole different situation. So that's my concern. I think it's a wonderful project. I think we need it. Just have issues about that ditch and, you know, safety. It's going to be a help, you know, children, family thing.
Let me, Mark, is this, and let me, and piggyback on that one second, Ines. The swale up here or the retention pond, so this water on here is being directed to that.
Right.
And then it's going to be directed primarily into the big ditch.
Right.
Okay. Over.
At anything would be.
The idea is this goes to our pond, which would then convey it to the city conveyance. And it would seem to me that it's incumbent upon us to engineer the whole site, not just our little sliver. I mean, I understand your concern about stormwater.
Just
it's completely relevant and fair. But it's also relevant and fair that we are going to affect it, that we're going to engineer it.
One of the things that's in conversation this week, you're talking about having a park there. Evidently, you've got to have some sort of engineered stormwater. We're thinking about being able to combine those and making it work.
The other thing in conversation was, this idea of stormwater, 12 years I was on the board, we fussed about stormwater continually. And I've always said we don't need a retention situation, we need a filtering situation because our water table is so high. But there's some discussions going on right now where that ditch that they put in, it's literally a flowing baffle where the slows the water down and retains it there longer. And that's it. We're going to see if that can work and help the city as well. And I'm not an engineer by any stretch of imagination, but that's the conversations that we have going on with the engineering firm.
That's in the thought process now. Of course, in the thought process now.
Yeah, we're looking, trying to get everything, not just for this, but the city's got to have something if we can combine it. If we can slow this water down, like you said, when the water gets to run, we have 10 inches of rain, like that, the ditch flows like crazy. We want to slow it down. That's what we need to do for the city in some of these areas to create.
You've seen the baffles where they got the little V on and put across that ditch or something.
Right. I've seen one where they put where it just snakes at it too.
Yeah, so that accelerates the water so that it can cause erosion damage.
Right now, there's quite a few trees or pines, I believe. I was looking down and not up, but I think from going there, there's kind of a row of pine trees here. And you talked about landscaping the site. Are you going to have enough area with that ditch there to be able to landscape that with some shade tree?
Well, this is, here again, the survey was just out this past week, and I have not gotten a plat back yet. But Mark was by there looking at the stakes. It looks like the stakes may actually be on the ditch side of the fence. My thought was, if it is, we don't want to go. We want to come back to the inside of the fence, and we still have enough space, the 300, because when we measure out there initially for this, the 375 going towards the road, towards the bus barn, we still had extra footage before you got to the road. So we may have to come back again and say we need to.
The interesting thing about this is we're describing that parcel, so that parcel may need to shift a little north or a little south or a little east or a little west in order to get the best condition. And I do believe we'll have to put some fill on that site, even if it's just the building pads. We'll have to elevate that site because these are anticipated because of the handicap requirements to be slab on grade, which is also not typical.
And I'd rather this slip toward the barn up there rather than coming, because you do have neighbors. They've got new houses going in out there. You've got neighbors
over there. I understand that.
I've received probably 5 phone calls in the last week. Somebody got word that people out there. And I'd like for y'all to have a public hearing in a way of the next time y'all come or even before then, and not just because there's a lot of rumors going around. We need to have where you can explain to more people than just this or the interest of people, mail out Spetty or something. I might put that in form of
a regular meeting.
Just to have y'all explain to them, like, it's not going to be subsidy housing. It's not going to be this, because we're going to, you know, for our mouth, it's going to get twisted.
Is it going to lower my tax bill?
We appreciate it.
Pay the taxes, so I don't have to pay 20 mils on a place that's going to be a highway with 100 more cars going by my house every day.
And low-income housing. There's a lot of young families in that area that would love to be out here because this does pose a risk for anyone who has small children. The highway, I mean, the road, the traffic on that road is already horrible. And then you add something like this, and then you're talking about this huge ditch.
Down.
Yeah, we're going to have this staggered ditch in front of our property from an extra storm water. It's going to cause a lot of problems for people in that neighborhood. There will be a lot of families that would be interested in being part of this.
Anyway,
how does water get to your side of the road and one side of the road?
It has. I've got pictures and videos. There's been gators in that ditch.
That ditch is normally always half full anyway, and stagnant. And then when it rains, it'll fill up. So
it goes
generally, all the time, it's half full anyway with stagnant water.
I've been out there for the last few weeks checking this because I don't see that same
thing. We've been living there for 12 years, so the last few weeks really done.
I've been there since 97.
You're on 17th Street, right?
Yes, sir. We live right by where the entrance
will be. Directly across from the entrance.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
And my fault, too. You know, it's not but three or four blocks down. We have
another. I just have questions, and I'm sorry.
You know, we have two low-income projects just a few blocks down, two on 24th Street. Then a couple blocks up from that, our property, we've got the projects right there, too, on Avenue H. So right there where we live, that's going to be the fourth low-income.
Let's put it on 14th Street in the historic district.
Yeah.
Yeah, let's do that. Anybody that lives on the south side have anything to say about it?
If it's zoned properly, I wouldn't.
But I'm just saying, you know, the property values, I may as well just give my house away.
We're living in the city limits and paying city limit property taxes.
But having to deal with,
I mean, this couldn't go somewhere outside of the city limits?
The problem we're dealing with is, that's one of my questions. They presented us with a map that literally it dissected part of the old school property there, and the lower where the old project is, I guess the old project there on whatever that street.
Apalachicola Housing Authority.
Right. Yes. That was not even a qualifying area. It had to be to the north of that, and that's why this
right,
project
is. Right. Well, keep
going. We don't dictate where the land is. The IRS dictates where the zone is.
So what are y'all going to do for me? That's all I'm going to know. What are you going to do for the people that are living there?
We're going to build affordable housing people, so people that you use to clean the units and do that.
No, those people can't afford to live there. They don't make $24,000 a year. Y'all are crazy if you think it's true, though. Y'all are crazy.
Yeah. Teachers? Look at the other affordable housing that's in town. Are there teachers and firefighters and police officers over there? No.
Well, it depends on how you qualify for them. So if those on 24th Street.
And you know, bring their dogs because they all got hunt dogs.
Qualified, and this is like we're holding the same requirements. And that was one of the things that they're telling us. And I'm doing my best to understand all of this as well because I didn't realize there were so many different methods of qualifying. This one does not have the government regulations as it relates to filling out certain forms. It's just an income thing. It's not, you don't have to make above 24, but up to 24 is where it begins. So lesser people make less than that to qualify easier. But 24 is where it starts for a one person, one bedroom. If you make above 24, then you wouldn't qualify. But if you're married, you got a couple of kids, or you're a single dad or a mom with a couple of kids, you can make up to $34,000, $36,000 and still qualify.
I was telling them earlier that for some reason I've gotten the reputation of being the person that knows what's available for rent in this area. And there aren't very many homes. But I have never had one call for an apartment. No one has asked me in the last 2 years if we have any apartments available for rent. We want 3-bedroom, 2-bath homes with grass around them so they can have their dogs. And they want to pay $800 a month or $700 a month. And of course, that's not available right now. But this doesn't answer. It's like, if you build it, they will come? Bullshit.
There's a way to list it on the project on 24.
That's
the
project.
That's
low income. No, the waiting list people for the projects are not your target. It's not your target.
Or that's what you're telling us, they're not your target. But sounds contradictory.
I went out there and talked to those people to try to get a feel for this so I'd have an understanding. And they told me that only a, like, out of a 30-unit complex, they have to keep 3 or 4 out where you don't have to fill out certain government documents, or you can qualify a different way, where you, if you have a certain amount of income, you can get in there. And there's always a long waiting line. The other people that are in there, they have to have subsidized housing, and there's always a list for them as well. But the other people that don't qualify, a lot of people don't qualify for subsidized housing, but they still need affordable housing, and that's what this does. And I'm telling you, these people we're working for, Mark and I are not building this, I want you to know that. We are working for other people that have done this around the state, and they've got a long history, and they
this
know more about
this. This is not Miami, this is not Key West.
You're right, but we still have needs for affordable housing here, though, Kathy.
I still feel that the community needs to know
the community is going to know.
Let them come and voice their opinions, because there would be more people here had they known.
We appreciate y'all having a special meeting. The only reason we requested this the week, and I was on board, if you remember, we had it twice a month every month anyway. But the only reason we're here is because for them to be able to make an application, they've got to have enough time to get your plans and that.
So on a later date, you wouldn't have a problem, and I know you won't. I want you to be able to explain and ease their minds. But like I said, I had five just in a week.
Yeah.
And I don't know when that would be better to have, whether it be closer to when this
probably be mid-September when we have much more refined plans and site plans for people to respond to, because I'd actually like to hear all of that.
Well,
and actually, and that we're going to develop around more land, so y'all can voice that instead of me being a conduit of your concerns.
You know, y'all are the residents out there, and I personally believe y'all ought to need to know what's coming down the pipe. It's our too. It's the whole multifamily.
That's the problem. Man.
So, but, you know, so but you need to know and let them explain to you what that whether this is, you know, some good or not good project.
But understand though that in your neighborhood, yes, you have apartment complex, you've got duplexes and condos.
No, we don't need more. Understand.
Jim, what's the length of time?
You can't even let your kids play in the front yard on the street because of the traffic.
Well, maybe you said moving up, it won't be transition.
Don't you think that's a traffic issue then? I mean,
but
that's not the
traffic.
It needs to address that to slow it down. There's
more than just the traffic.
One person can stay forever. We have one person talk at a time. I can't follow all this.
That's just, let's go. A very reasonable place. If you want to be identified and speak, please let me know. I'll identify you. Jesus. Somebody in the back won't speak. I mean, you can cut anybody off, but I want you to, so we don't have multiple people talking at the time.
I would like to know if you are going to have a meeting, have this well advertised so everyone knows what's going on. I mean, we've had other things that kind of snuck in the back door. I don't want this to sneak in the back door. You know, I'm very vocal about what I feel is appropriate and proper, and I'll vocalize my opinion, but everybody needs to be able to weigh in and not just have this, oh, surprise, now we have a new apartment complex.
Well, We have had previous meetings about it. I mean, it's not like this is the first time. But
right.
Would you entertain a motion to that Betty and Jim Tommy get together five, and it'd be a better time for them to get together, just whether it's September or whatever.
Yeah,
and then do the...
Let me be very clear. We're not trying to sneak anything anywhere. This is our second appearance. We asked for a request so we can be prepared for... this application, that there is a formal meeting that is our understanding, my understanding, it would be required anyway. It would be a full open meeting to the public, and I'll bring the developer.
Very good. That work? Then, when in time and place, and our time, and then advertise it in the paper.
If the project's not chosen, you don't have to worry about it anyway. If it is chosen,
that's what I'm.
We still have an opportunity to sit there and address each one of those issues and tweak it and work it out. There's a lot going on out there that's going to be great for the city of Apalachicola. And you might not think there's a need for affordable housing, but there really is. We've got the city's got after-school programs going out there. They're talking about developing another playground park out there for the kids. We've got the summer program, or it's all year long now, I guess, they're at the gymnasium. So there's a lot going on that these people can benefit from. There's no other housing units that I know of around town that have a pool. This one's going to have a pool for them.
Oh, that's a whole other problem.
But that's their problem, it's not your problem.
No, I live across the street, so it is my problem.
But that's a question that you could answer for them and tell them about how they're going to be maintained. Because y'all told us in the initial meeting that it would be definitely maintained because it's inspected every so often by these.
We did have a phone meeting with the city commissioners. They approved it, and we came to planning the zoning last fall. And everything just kind of stopped because they couldn't put in an application. And now we're back for the trying to put in an application because they're finding Florida Housing Finance Corporation is actually allowing it this time. So that's why we're back with the increased.
Well, and people kind of knew that it got put on hold, so that's why no one spoke out more. But now that it's back.
Well, I made a request for an update.
Are you going to approve them going forward with?
We're not at that juncture. That's why I read out loud what a certificate of appropriateness. All we're talking about is the use and the design and look. Well, one of the things that Ms. Forrest suggested, y'all went back and did, and I think it looks much better than what I saw before, which is, you know, you're not going to have a back and a front. So we're making progress, okay? So this is not a final.
Yeah, this is a good change. Good.
So this is collaboration. From my point of view, I'm speaking for Robin here. I'm looking at the zoning. I'm looking at the setbacks of the concerns that, I said, aesthetically, I think it's only execution. But unfortunately, there's nothing in nothing that they've presented other than what I said, safety issues that is objectionable aesthetically. It's zoned for that number of units, up to 20 units per acre.
We're actually less.
And, pardon me?
We're actually less.
Yes, yeah, slightly correct. Less. So at this point, it's all going to be about the execution and the management. I mean, if it's well done and well landscaped, that's why I asked questions about the trees and so on. If there was a screen area, but it could be awful too. So at this point, I feel that that's the juncture we're at, is that we need to have another input meeting, have it better publicized and have some more input, and then we can collaborate on some of these issues. Because I presume that if the neighborhood wanted certain types of screen or fencing and so on, there's enough negotiation room there for some of that.
You wouldn't object to that? What we tried to do is meet the letter of the code and the responses to the comments that we got last time.
We're looking at the amount of space there is between the front porch, which juts out, that entryway, which juts out, which is nice. It's out of the rain. That's our double door. It helps keep from being a flat space, which is nice. But it looks as though those little porches are almost right to the edge.
They're about 5 feet from the sidewalk, and the sidewalk is about 5 feet wide.
To the porch edge or to the building as it indents?
To the porch edge.
Well, so a larger scale would allow for that because it's really hard to tell. But, of course, landscaping is an issue that we're all concerned with.
Right.
Is there room for trees? I mean, I see that the trees are appropriately placed in the green space, but I don't see any possibility of any room around the edge of the building that's the streetscape, which is 17th, which is most of the traffic. Hopefully,
and again, this is really quite schematic because we haven't received a survey
yet.
Right, so
we're agreeing. So that the next step, I for one would like to be able to see
actually the landscape needs to be all the way around and make it nice.
Well, the issue with the trees here, when I asked about the trees, Mr. Tommy, is because I'm wondering with that being the egress, if they're going to cut them down because of sight lines and. Those are some pretty big trees there, and that would really just totally eliminate any privacy screen that people on 17th Street would have. So
will the next step be able to be a larger, and with the existing trees, which ones have to go and which ones are going to remain, that would help the neighbors?
We're still defining the parcel.
Sure.
So right now the parcel we have to shift 5 or 10 feet to the west and 5 or 10 feet to the south to get to be out of the ditch and be clear of the trees.
Right. And of course the pool is going to be fenced in.
You know the process. We'll all be examined.
Yeah, right. Okay.
I can tell you this, that the city of Key West, I guess, it has an extraordinary landscape requirement. Mm-hmm. And we were well beyond our landscape requirement.
Right.
It
in Key West, we built this so that it, the streets pass through it. That it's not a compound, that it's just buildings on the street.
Right.
And it's because that's the only way that it can be built there. And they were very sensitive to the city's needs for walls, garden walls and landscapes. So I think this developer will do the same.
So we'll be able to see that at some point soon.
When we come back in probably mid-September.
Sure, sure.
Okay.
I do want to ask, this is really minor, but why is there a laundry room when every unit has washer and dryer in it? And why is it such a big laundry room?
It's got six. We ask the same questions.
Yeah. What a waste. I mean, it kind of encourages
people
doing commercial laundry in there.
The answer to that is if you read the Florida Housing Qualification Statement, you get extra points. And you have to get a certain number of points to be considered for application.
Right.
And the point total is 64. One of the projects that we did in Miami came up with 59. So your clothes are in the garden.
So you wash your clothes in your house, and then you go down there and wash your commercial. And the other thing is, I don't see any bathroom facilities, but nothing which would require showering before you go in the pool. I mean, that's small stuff, and I'm sure you'll add other stuff. That's just an observation.
All those things are in. The application is really quite extensive.
Right.
And you get 1 point here, 2 points there. You get a point for being cable ready. You get a point for having, you know, and it's interesting, y'all keep saying the word low income. We haven't said the word low income yet, okay? Affordable housing.
Right.
Housing previous would have never had internet service. Now it cannot not happen. So there's a lot of things that are upscaling this that I think you really need to consider, and I think kind of have to have an open mind about what your conception of affordable housing is. And the other thing that is, never mind, let's say
it.
Well, I resent that you keep saying those people, to be blunt. Those people are people too, and they need a place to live. And our developer feels very strongly about that. Whatever those people are.
At this point, I think we can safely say we can call for a vote of the appropriateness of the project, subject to return for the final landscape, I mean, whatever, all those pieces of it.
Well, that really is just the next stage. It's not. I'm not sure it's even final. It's pre-application, because we're going to give you much larger architectural plans, a full landscape plan, a fully engineered site to look at.
Right. So, is that? Did you make a move?
I can't, but you can. I mean, I'm saying at this point, whoever wants to adopt as much, make that motion. Okay. So, we have a second.
Second.
All those in favor, vote aye. Opposed?
And we will continue to do everything we can to solve this. Apalachicola's got a lot of problems. But we're making inroads. We are making some changes. And I don't think all the traffic has to go down 17th Street. It can go down Avenue L. But there's ways to track these things or stop these things. I mean, there's less people in Apalachicola now than when I grew up here. You know, that's it. We have faster cars and more people with cars. We didn't have that many cars when I was a girl. In fact, those days, we still fight Indians on the way. We were fighting Indians on the way to school. Anyway.
I live on 17th Street, so I understand the traffic issue. I'm concerned about that, but I truly believe for this city to continue to thrive, we've got to have places that people can afford to do it, and housing is going to be hard. There are some very detailed studies about the need for housing in this area. So.
It just seems that there are other viable options in Franklin County.
Well,
Franklin County in general. It doesn't have to be in the city limits.
And that's part of what we talked about earlier. There are very, very tight restrictions in what geographic area you put in.
Most of this is driven by demographics.
I get that, but we're talking about a couple blocks. So this is that restrictive? Is this got to be this?
Well, actually, it is, because
Bring the map.
I'll have to show you the map because, like I said, it cuts football field.
You still have it?
This is the black right here. This is where you've got the R2s and the high density, which is what they need.
Well, we're talking about.
Yes, I know you're talking.
So when I say that,
but I'm just saying
if you overlay that map where there is R2, it is a very narrow slice.
Why can't you move to East Point or Carabel or
there's not a qualified zone
here. Place besides where you know we're trying to get our property values up, and this is just going to tank. There's no question about it. Your house is going to go.
Excuse me.
That's going to affect all of us.
Thank you. Appreciate it. We'll be back. Well, keep getting warm and let you know what's going on.
One last thing, I think I said about everybody on the planning zoning board, the reception for our treasurer for presentation can go this Friday night at Bobbin's studio, so we'll have to say that.
So we really need y'all to be there. Danny, you meet her Friday night?
Me? I have to go with my husband's having surgery. I have to be in Miami for surgery.
There are people from the Board of Trust that remember.
I know.
From Coral Gables,
so
to see.
I'm
dragging them all up here and they're going down.
Oh, right. I know he has triage.
So I have a motion to adjourn.
Motion.
A fellow from a realtor from Denton called me a week or so ago and was asking about some properties down here. And he says, is Linda Wilson still up there? I said, yes, yes. I knew her. I used to do sold for somebody. I called her and Maya. I said, she's still here. I'm sure she'd like to see.
How's your dad? I like him a lot. He's a good guy.
Do you want the justification
for the which I gave him the report? I'll have to slide
in and say,
good seeing you. Good seeing you too, Jack. Take care of yourself.